Greetings. My name is Joshua Binus, and I'm the industry foresight lead within the corporate strategy organization at the Bonneville Power Administration. The following presentation is part one of a seven-part video series focused on exploring the long-term electric power industry landscape. If you haven't already, please take a few minutes to view the introduction to the series for some valuable context. Hopefully you'll find this time spent viewing the video to be very valuable. Please feel free to send me an email with any feedback. Enjoy. Changing environmental conditions will increasingly impact the water supplies and hydropower production capacity of the American West. And here, one of the key things that we're looking at is that over time, what we're expecting to see is an uneven but average increase in outside air temperatures. Now, the impact that that's going to have on our precipitation means that over time, as the air gets warmer, we expect to have our precipitation change, so we've got more of our precipitation over the course of the year coming down as rain rather than snow. And for some of the sub-basins within the Northwest, this is not going to have a huge impact, like in the Willamette River Basin, which will be rain dominant and will stay rain dominant. But however, some of the basins in the Northwest, like the Snake River Basin, and I'll show you on the blow up here, are going to shift from being snow dominant to rain dominant. And you don't have to get too caught up in the A1B and the B1 scenarios here. These are just scenarios from this climate change study. There's not a lot of divergence between these scenarios up to mid-century. The divergence really starts taking place in the latter part of the century. But you can see that we are expecting to see a decrease in the snow-dominant sub-basins within the Columbia River Basin in the Northwest. Now, also, one of the other things that we're expecting to continue as a trend is that we've seen this trend of very heavy precipitation events increasing in the Northwest, as in much of the rest of the country. Of course, nothing like what we're seeing east of the Mississippi. But basically, even if our annual precipitation levels increase, the chances are good that a portion of that is going to be coming down as heavier rain events, maybe not necessarily more rain days over the course of the year, which could happen, but we could see some intensification of the rain events that we're seeing, and that would continue the trend that we've seen over the last century. Now, the basic reason for this is not too hard to get your head around. As the oceans are warming and as the air is warming above the oceans, the evaporation coming out of the oceans up into the atmosphere above them is increasing, and keeping in mind that warm air can hold more moisture than cold air. So once you have a whole bunch of moisture sitting in the air above the oceans, all it takes is the right wind pattern to push it over land, and then we get to experience what some people call atmospheric rivers or lakes as they come over land and then just dump on us. But we could see some intensification of the rain events that we're seeing, and that would continue the trend that we've seen over the last century. Now, the impact that that's going to have on the Columbia River's hydrograph, you know, what we expect to see is that, you know, compared to the historical baseline where, you know, traditionally we have our snowpack over the winters, and then as it melts in the summer, we have a peak in the summer freshet that happens in the spring and early to midsummer, and then a tightening of the water supplies in the mid to late summer. And what we're expecting is that over the course of the winters moving forward, as more of the precipitation comes down as rain, we'll end up with more water in the system in the winters, which is not a terrible thing from a provisioning of load, because we're still primarily a winter peaking region. You know, so we'll have more water in the hydro system to meet those winter peaks, and that's not a terrible thing from an electricity production perspective. However, that's not going to erase the pain point that we're expecting in the mid to late summer, as we end up with a lot less water in the system and just less flexibility for electricity production, for management of the river, for non-electric power needs like fish management in particular. And we're also seeing, you know, in correlation with these reduced summer flows, you know, that mid to late summer is gonna be pretty tough in some areas. Also, along with that, we can expect an expansion of the fire regime in the Northwest. So you can expect that this wildfire regime is probably going to start earlier in the year, run a little later into the year. And the geography of those fire hazards is also going to increase. So for organizations that have assets out in the field in some of these areas, you know, we're going to have to pay really close attention to vegetation control around towers and equipment to make sure that the assets that are out there are well protected moving forward. Now, lastly, we're also expecting to see more pressure put on the generation types across all of the American West, especially in the Southwest, where, you know, even if precipitation levels remain the same, because outside air temperatures are going to be trending upward, what we can, you know, really expect is that even if the precipitation levels were to remain the same, with air temperatures increasing, that increases the rate of evaporation, or I believe the term is transevaporation, from the soils and plants, so that you can find yourself more quickly in these arid areas into those warm plus dry conditions that kind of lead to droughts, they lead to wildfires and some of these other things. So what we can expect on top of policy pressure dealing with carbon is some policy pressure dealing with freshwater scarcity in especially the arid parts of the American West. This is a really busy slide, so let me walk you through it real quick. So, you know, here what we can see along the bottom are different generation types. They're organized by their cooling strategies across the top. And then the data here is tallied are the estimations of water withdrawals from these generation types. And in blue, it's measured as a withdrawal along the left in gallons per megawatt hour. And a withdrawal is when water is taken out of the system, used to cool a plant, and then returned to the environment in some kind of change condition, typically warmer, sometimes more toxic. The other tally here is in brown, and that's a measurement of water consumption, tallied over on the right. And here, you know, consumption is defined as, you know, water that's pulled out of the environment, used to boil to create steam to spin a turbine and then released into the atmosphere. So that's considered consumption. And here, you know, basically what you see is that, you know, the most high consumers of water are the thermals, nuclear and coal in particular, but also concentrated solar is pretty high in water consumption if it's water cooled. Air-cooled concentrated solar does not use anywhere near as much water, or closed-loop systems tend to use less. But on the far end of the other end of the spectrum, you've got wind power, solar PV, combined cycle natural gas plants that are all looking pretty good in their water consumption. So I think, you know, when we look out over the course of decades in the American West, there's other forces beyond just carbon reduction goals at the city and state level to actually pressure electric power generators to be citing generation types that are a lot less water intensive.